At the end of the 18th century, France saw the fall of absolute monarchy in favor of liberty, equality, and fraternity. The transfer of power to the people was not a quick or a quiet change, though. There was much violence and there were many executions, including both the king and the queen. Many symbols of royal and noble power, like the Bastille prison, were overrun, ransacked, and eventually torn and destroyed. A few years later, France saw another shift in power, this time to a dictator. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Why did power change hands twice? To answer that, let's go all the way back to the 17th century. It's the Age of Enlightenment, the Age of Reason, the Second Renaissance, or more specifically, the Renaissance Humanism. Some say it began with René Descartes' philosophy, I think, therefore I am, and Isaac Newton's mathematical principles of natural philosophy. During this scholarly time, there came many influential publications like the Encyclopedia and instrumental works by Voltaire, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Adam Smith, and Immanuel Kant. Using the base of science, math, and technology, these great thinkers advanced bold ideas about liberty, constitution and government, and separation of church and state. All things we take for granted today. Against this backdrop of humanism is Louis XIV. He did his best to keep such thinking out of France. After all, he was the absolute monarch. He was the state. He was the church. The Age of Enlightenment probably did not have much sway in France until his death in 1715. From then to the year 1789, France saw an increase in population, but a decrease in the economy. Add in a few financial missteps like the never-ending taxation on the commoners and a costly war spending spree. Mix in the encroachment of enlightenment and Louis XVI is in dire straits. He, however, attempted to fix it up by assembling the Estates General. Unfortunately, it was set up to be unfair to the majority, aka the commoners. And so they, wanting a democracy, formed their own government, the First French Republic. And now we are back to where we first started. So question to you, the viewers. What good is a king if you are now a republic? With the French Revolution well underway, there was tension with bordering countries. During these battles, a young military officer came to France's rescue, becoming the first consul and eventually becoming the Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte. Given this context of enlightenment and revolution of the people, the era of Rococo, of elegant lives of the noble class, of luxury and tranquility of the aristocracy, waned and yielded to the next classicism, neoclassicism, a perfect fit for a changing era of morals and politics, and a return to the classical teachings of one Nicolas Poussin and the French Royal Academy of Art. Recall that Poussin advocated a hierarchical system for painting genres, with history paintings as the number one rank. Historical paintings had many aspects that appealed to this period. They were large and epic in nature and size, showing heroes, displaying honor and virtues and morals. A wonderful canvas to push ideas about individualism, human rights. Almost feels like propaganda for rallying the people to join the great cause. Filled with awe-inspiring moral messages, idealism, and rational thinking. Stylistically, neoclassicism emphasized simplicity, symmetry, straight lines, minimal use of colors, ideal human forms harking back to the days of ancient Greco-Roman art. A stark departure from Rococo's attention to the ornate. Asymmetry, natural curves, a bright color palette, emotional and sensual aura. At the forefront of this neoclassicism art movement was French painter Jacques-Louis David, born in Paris, graduate and winner of the Royal Academy's Prix de Rome in 1774. David studied both Renaissance and 17th century masters such as Poussin and Raphael, including the newly discovered ruins of Pompeii in 1779. He painted for both King Louis XVI and then the French revolutionaries, becoming effectively the dictator of the arts. Then later, as Napoleon began to rise in stature and power, David again became the official court painter. Only this time, it was for an empire. So, to understand neoclassicism is to understand David's paintings. One of his masterpieces is Oath of the Horati. It depicts the Roman family Horati. Three brothers are chosen to represent Rome in a battle against a warring city. The brothers salute their father, who is holding their swords. The women and children are mourning and fear for the three brothers' lives. Theme-wise, there are displays of loyalty, patriotic duty, and self-sacrifice for country over family. The men display no emotions during the oath-taking, but the women do. They are weeping and full of despair. The painting setting has an element of a theater stage, bringing all the focus to the forefront. Technically, the brush strokes are invisible. The lines are clear. The colors are dull. It is very structured and organized around the number three. Three brothers, three women, three arches. Even the arms and legs of the men form a triangle shape. The human shapes are ideal and rigid, with all the action frozen in time. As the lead painter of his times, he attracted many students. One such student continued and elevated the neoclassical style. His name, Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, following in his teacher's footsteps. He too won the Prix de Rome in 1801 and studied all things classical. And as a defender of tradition and classicism, he came to represent the Poussinists, believing that lines and drawing were the most important in painting. Take for instance Ingres' painting, Napoleon the First on his imperial throne. It depicts Napoleon as emperor, wearing his coronation costume, sitting upon a very adorned throne. He is wearing a golden wreath, holding a scepter with his coronation sword by his side. Theme-wise, there's really just one, and it's pretty loud. Supreme Power, with inspiration from the statue of Zeus by ancient Greek sculptor Phidias, and God the Father by Northern Renaissance painter Jan van Eyck. And technically, very structured and highly organized, clear and straight lines. While devoted to classical and ancient techniques and masters, Eyck pursued for more beautiful forms, more harmonious lines, more expressiveness, and pushed the bounds of idealism of neoclassicism. These distortions and abstractions of form and space made him an important precursor of modern art. His best-known masterpiece, The Turkish Bath, had great influence on future greats like Picasso. And the Golden Age with Matisse. Neoclassicism was a time for a man to look back to classical antiquity, to rediscover Greco-Roman ideals, to use reason and science to advance new ideas. But it was the secrets of heaven and earth that I desired to learn. And whether it was the outward substance of things or the inner spirit of nature and the mysterious soul of man that occupied me, still my inquiries were directed to the metaphysical. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Be sure to subscribe to my channel for more videos like this.